was in Egypt's land, let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Go down, Moses says, way down in Egypt's land. Hello, Pharaoh, let my people go. Thus saith the Lord, bold Moses said, let my people go. If not, I'll smite your firstborn dead. Let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt's land. Tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. Shall they in bondage toil, let my people go. Let them come out with Egypt's spoil, let my people go. Go down.
A really fitting start to a new year, new school year, as we think about Moses, if you got that clue. Welcome to Gloria Day. My name is Martin Corns. I am the pastor here at Gloria Day, and it's great to see everybody here and other people that will be joining us watching this later on. I've got a couple of announcements to make. First one's, this has been a really challenging week for a lot of people, I think, with a number of sad things happening. And one of them is our brother Aaron, the life support was turned off earlier this week, and Aaron passed away on Thursday. So our thoughts and our prayers are with family and friends, Belaine, Jan, his mother, and others, who and each one of us as well. He will be missed. But the other side, Jocelyn and Austin and baby Finn, he's like 3 years old now, who come along to our service. I text Jocelyn because she was due on the 9th of September, and I said, has the baby come? And she said, yeah, it came like 2 weeks early. So they had a new baby girl on September the 1st, Rowan Jennifer. Jennifer is Jocelyn's sister's name, so Rowan, which is awesome. And then lunch today. Whether or not you brought anything or not, come and join us at our house. Hi there, Gwen. Gwen, you need to pick up one of those Exodus booklets at the back as well. That's it. You've got it. You've got everything. And a map, Gwen, because you need to know where, how to get to my house because of the food straight afterwards. I will try and get down there first so I unlock the door. So if you see me rush off, it's only so that you're not like kept outside, okay? Or if you see me screeching down past you on the highway, that's just, anyway, that's my excuse. Welcome, Pastor Brinkman and Nancy. It's good to have you folks here as well with us celebrating this morning. And two other things, Salvation Army, we continue to gather back-to-school items for their after-school club. So there's a box out there. Well, I think the nice box that somebody made went missing. So if it looks like there's like a Dorito box or something that's, you know. But pop your things in there. And then lastly, just like we did with our series on Mark last year, we're going through Exodus. We're only going through it from September to Christmas. And the book is about three times the size, which means you've got three times the amount of reading to do. Ah, I love setting you homework. And so when you get one of these, number one, what's the first thing you have to do? Put your name on it, right? Put your name on it. That's an important thing to do. It just means getting a pen, putting your name on it, okay? Because it's so big, I don't want to print too many off. So, and then bring this along. Bring it on Sundays and bring it on Wednesdays when we have our Bible study at 2 o'clock and at 5:30 because we're going to go into this in more depth as well. But I'm excited. I'm excited to look at the life of Moses. That's all our announcements. Let's just be quiet for a moment, shall we? As we've come into God's house this morning. I invite you to close your eyes as we come before the Lord God, recognizing we are in His presence. As the Lord God said to Moses, take off your shoes. This is holy ground. Let's allow the Lord to speak to us despite the struggles, the joys, the pains that we've been through this week. As we draw close to the Lord through His word and through sacrament today. Father God, thank you for bringing us into your house. Thank you, Lord God, that you are here through the presence and power of your Holy Spirit. Lord God, we pray that you may use this opportunity to draw us closer to you. And to send us out, Father God, with the message of good news to share with others. Bless us, we pray. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So our worship this morning begins in the way our lives in Christ in baptism began. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. And we move into our time of confession as we do, as we come into church, recognizing the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And often, we don't treat Him as number one in our lives. Other things come in. I just invite you in the quietness, come before the Lord God, saying, Lord God, I'm sorry that I often turn my back on you, or I just forget you because of the rush of life. Just be quiet for a moment. On page 3 in the bulletin and on the screen. Let us confess our need for God's ongoing grace. Gracious and loving God, we find it difficult at times to place our trust in you
and live up to what we are chosen to be. Too often we look at the world and see only violence, pain, destruction, and signs of hopelessness and despair. We fail to see our role, what you have chosen us to do.
Too often we rely on our own strength, our own plans, our own devices, rather than trusting in your hand to hold us, your love to sustain us, and your desire to see us through.
Forgive us, Holy One. Help us turn to you when we are lost, that we might find our way home. Help us navigate the treacherous waters of this world, that we might experience your abundant grace, mercy, and love. Help us put our trust in you, that the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus may shine in our lives for all to see. Amen.
And brothers and sisters, as we come in confession to the Lord God, seeking his forgiveness, the good news is, because of what Jesus Christ has done for each one of us, I can declare that promise to us, that it is because of Jesus that all our sins are forgiven. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. And there's a prayer that's on the screen and on page 4. Let's say this together.
God of abundant grace, may your Holy Spirit be with us now as we seek to discover and celebrate our choosiness in you. Open our eyes to truly see one another, that we might discover your presence in the need of a neighbor. Open our ears to the needs of the world, that we might hear your wisdom in the words spoken around us, and open our hearts to your grace and love, that we might find guidance and strength for the journey, finding in you who we are chosen to be.
Amen. One thing we're going to learn as we go through the book of Exodus is that God is indeed faithful and he can be trusted. The Israelites are going to find that out, and we too, as we read this story, are going to find that out also. So we're going to sing about that. Great is thy faithfulness. If you're able to, please stand with me as we sing together.
Thou changest not.
come and bring us our Old Testament and Epistle readings in a moment. The Old Testament picks up on part of what we're looking at today. But I would encourage you to go away and read Exodus 1 and 2. And then following week will be Exodus 3 and 4. And then the reading from Hebrews in the New Testament picks up what we were looking at last week of the faith of Moses. Thank you, Julie.
A reading from the Old Testament, Exodus. Now there arose a new king over Egypt who did not know Joseph. And he said to his people, "Behold, the people of Israel are too many and too mighty for us. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply. And if war breaks out, they join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to afflict them with heavy burdens. They built for Pharaoh store cities, Pithom and Ramses, but the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied, and the more they spread abroad. And the Egyptians were in dread of the people of Israel, so they ruthlessly made the people of Israel work as slaves and in the field. They made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in all kinds of work. In all of their work, they ruthlessly made them work as slaves. Then the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Sipprah and the other Puah, "When you serve as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a son, you shall kill him. But if it is a daughter, she shall live." But the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but let the male children live. So the king of Egypt called the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this? And let the male children live." The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women. They are rigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and grew very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all of his people, "Every son that is born to the Hebrews, you shall cast into the Nile, but you should let every daughter live." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle letter lesson from Hebrews. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents, because they saw that the child was beautiful, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. By faith, the people crossed the Red Sea as on dry land, but the Egyptians, when they attempted to do the same, were drowned. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Julie. One of the things we read through the story of Moses is that God will say, Moses, you're not going to enter the promised land. And yet we have the transfiguration scene. And I sometimes imagine that when Moses is chatting with Elijah, they're sort of nudging each other. And Elijah's saying to Moses, see, you did finally make it here. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And Jesus was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces, and they were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, rise and have no fear. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. And the disciples asked him, then why do the scribes say that first Elijah may come? He answered, Elijah does come, and he will restore all things. But I tell you that Elijah has already come, and they did not recognize him, but did to him whatever they pleased. So also the Son of Man will certainly suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he was speaking to them of John the Baptist. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you.
Before we have our message, we're going to sing again, as the deer pants for the water, so our souls long after the Lord God. Let's stand if we're able to and sing together.
More than
Please take your seats. And so we're going to be going through this book. So I hope you all grab it and you begin to read it. And you might even, in the sermons, on the Bible study especially, make notes in it. That's why we've got a booklet of this, so you won't mind scribbling all over it, which is useful. Let's pray together. Father God, thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you, Lord God, that we can look at these saints of old and be inspired as to how you were working out your plan. And Lord God, speak to us now through your word, we pray. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So if I was to mention Egypt, what would you think of? Maybe like the picture, the pyramids, the Sphinx, maybe the River Nile. Because today I'm excited that we're going to look at actually one of the longest books in the Bible. 40 chapters, so you better get reading, right? And we've only got like 10 or 12 weeks to cover it in. We're thinking about the Exodus, the departure of the Israelites from Egypt. And maybe for a lot of us, we've got a lot of those stories in our head from Sunday school and from the movies. And what I hope is that we'll be able to put that in some sort of order. Maybe Moses, Prince of Egypt, was your favorite cartoon telling. And you just loved it when the grandkids or the younger kids came round because you had another excuse to watch this movie again. I remember as I was thinking this through, I remember being at a friend's house with my family. I must have been 7 or 8. And we sat down, and it was a dark room. There was a TV in the corner. We sat down and watched not the Charlton Heston movie, but it was a Burt Lancaster series called Moses the Lawgiver. And I didn't really know the story of Moses. And the episode they were watching was all the frivolity of like around the golden calf. And I remember being absolutely shocked by what I saw. What are your memories? What are your memories? What do you remember? What stories do you have in your head as soon as I say Moses? It could be Moses in the basket in the River Nile as a baby. Moses going to Pharaoh and saying, "Let my people go." Maybe we remember some of the songs as well. Or the crossing of the Red Sea and that dramatic episode. But this story is also about slavery. It's about suffering. It's about 40 years wandering around in the wilderness as God taught and prepared his people as they were going to enter the promised land. And I hope that as we go through this book together, that we'll be challenged, we'll be amazed as we see God's power at work. We'll witness God moving in history. God who stayed faithful, even though sometimes it didn't look as though he was around. And I hope that we will also grow in confidence of our own history as we see God working not just through Moses, but through scriptures, drawing each one of us to the promised land through what Christ has done for us. Now, just put it in some perspective. Moses was born around 1536 BC. And what really excites me is, I mean, he was there in Egypt 40 years, left the Midian 40 years, and came back again, take the Israelites out. But what's really exciting is that, just like my wife and myself were tourists a few years ago, I didn't know I looked that young until I looked at that picture. But actually, the pyramids of Giza and the Great Sphinx were already there. So Moses was obviously a tourist like I was. I mean, I'm sure I saw some of his graffiti on there somewhere. I wonder, have you watched the Lord of the Rings trilogy? It may be something you're really into. You may have even read the book as well. Good for you. Now, if you haven't, if you're not into it, you're not going to have a clue what I'm referring to, okay? But if you read like the prologue in the book, it gives some information which will help you with the rest of the book. It tells you how these rings were forged, and it'll tell you about some of the background of how we got to where we are. Well, actually now there's a new prequel out, new series, Rachel and myself started watching it, called The Rings of Power, which tells this story before the story. Now, in our studies, we're going to be thinking about the book of Exodus, right? Okay. But just to put it in the context of the Bible, after that, remember the book that comes after Exodus, Numbers. We won't go into too much of it, but Number continues the story with Moses more as now an experienced older leader. And then you've got the book of Deuteronomy, which will continue us through to another character we know, which is Joshua. But there's also a prequel to the story of Moses. If you've read through the story of Genesis and then you come to the end, you actually feel a bit cheated. Because you say, well, hang on a minute, God made a bunch of promises to this group of people, and yet you're left hanging because the promises are not yet fulfilled. And so actually to grasp what Exodus is about, you have to understand a little bit of Genesis, which is why I'm just putting it in context as we move through over the next weeks. Remember Genesis, how God created the world, and then the people were told to go forward, be fruitful, and multiply. But what did the people do? They decided, if you remember, to turn their back on God. There was the fall, there was judgment, there was Noah and that big ark. And yet, through this, God is still working out his plan to save his people. And he calls Abraham and Sarah to go from Ur towards Canaan. A bit like the beginning of Genesis, they're told to go forth and multiply. God made a covenant with them, a promise with Abraham. We have that dramatic scene where he takes him out and looks at the stars in the sky and said, you will have that many descendants. And also for each one of us as followers of Jesus Christ, we are part of that promise, that covenant. And if you know the story, you'll know that Abraham and Sarah looked at each other, they laughed because they were actually both old. But Sarah, of course, did give birth to Isaac. Isaac has a son, Jacob, and also a son, Esau. And Jacob's name was then changed to Israel after he wrestled with God, which is where we then get the names Israelites from. Because you had 12 sons of Jacob, 12 tribes of Israel. So Exodus 1 is a repeat then. We didn't have that bit read this morning, but I encourage you to go back and read it. It's a repeat of the end of Genesis. But we've still got to work out, how do we get to Egypt? What is that all about? Because they were like, they were in Canaan. So what happened? They were in the promised land. The writer in Exodus, Moses, is going to remind us of the names of each of Jacob's sons. I'm glad he reminds us of them, because some of them are really quite confusing to remember, apart from Joseph, which is probably one of the reasons why we remember his name. Although, of course, we also remember him because he was then, his brother got really jealous of him. And they were going to kill him. Rather than kill him, they sold him off into slavery. And where did Joseph head to? To Egypt. Joseph headed to Egypt. And eventually, though, in this incredible story, Jacob and his sons will also go to Egypt. Joseph has now risen to be the position of prime minister. Can you believe that? And Jacob and his sons come as refugees because of a famine in Canaan. And Egypt had food because of the leadership of Joseph. So that's how they got to Egypt. Joseph then, they stay there. They lived in the land of Goshen. Joseph dies around the age of 110 in about 1804 BC. And there were now 70 descendants. Remember the promise that God had? That you have descendants as many as the stars in the sky? We're on 70 at the minute. They're doing well, right? God's promise is going to be worked out. Between that gap of Genesis and Exodus, we're going to see some incredible things. Over that 300, 350 years, we're told in verse 7 there, but the people of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly. How fruitful? They grew to around 3 million people. And you may look at that and go, how did that happen? Well, some people, you've got more time than I've got, smarter than I've got, well, they've got bigger calculators, have worked out that, a couple having six children, then have six children, then have six children, you know, that's how you do it, okay? So they did it. So God keeps his promise despite being absent. But God's also going to keep his promise despite the suffering. Because the Israelites are now going to head towards a time of suffering, if we know the story. Because what happened after a couple of hundred years, a new Pharaoh is in town. A new Pharaoh who doesn't know about Joseph. He doesn't know all that Joseph's done. And things are going to go downhill pretty fast for the Israelites. Pharaoh's going to enslave the people for his own political gain. And he's going to use really wicked, evil tools of fear and oppression and genocide. Verse 10 said, come, let us deal shrewdly with them, Pharaoh said, lest they multiply, and if war breaks out, they join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land. The Israelites were given a task. They built for Pharaoh store cities, Pithom and Ramses. And this is on this map. It's not on the map in the book. We'll be writing that in later on. See Goshen at the top north there near the Mediterranean Sea? That's the area that the Israelites were in. Ramses and Pithom, those are the storehouses that they were built in. And what's the significance of those storage cities? Remember back to Joseph? He had the job of organizing the collecting of all the crops into storehouses. And it's this bitter irony that the descendants of Joseph are still continuing to build in those areas. The Egyptians were making the Israelites work so hard because they were not only trying to break their spirits, but they were, of course, trying to stop them increase in number. But God keeps his promise despite the suffering. We're told in verse 12, but the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied, and the more they spread abroad. They actually grew so large that they were in the area of Goshen, but they had to then spread out. And so the Egyptians, of course, then got really worried because the Israelites were starting to spread into their land also. And verse 23, their cry for rescue from slavery came up to God. At this time when they were being so put down and oppressed, they cried out to God and he heard them. In the midst of all their trials, God is still fulfilling his promises, his blessings. The promises, remember, that we've laid out in Genesis to Abraham, God is still working that through. And perhaps when we read this passage, when we read some of the other passages in the scriptures, we might ask, why did God have to do it this way? What happened to those babies earlier on in the story? That was horrendous. What, wasn't there a better, nicer, more peaceful way? If God is all powerful, why did he have to do it this way? And even today, when we see atrocious scenes around us in the world, we ask, what is God doing? And sometimes, I think, as followers of Jesus, we get this idea that everything's going to be wonderful. That because we follow Jesus, there's going to be no more pain and no more suffering. And this week at Glory Day, a lot of us have really had some struggles. And we think, God, why is that? God, you should be blessing us if we follow you. So that there is no more suffering. We actually even think the reverse is true sometimes. That if there's suffering in our lives, maybe God has left us. Or we've done something wrong. And this is punishment. No, that is not the case. Even in the suffering, God is still working out his purposes, even if we don't always see and understand them. And we might cry out to God and say, God, why do you do it this way? I didn't sign up for cancer. I didn't sign up for worry. I didn't sign up for not knowing how to pay the bills. I didn't sign up for stress at work, for sleepless nights, for broken relationships. God, help me to understand your promise in all this. And I hope that as we go through the book of Exodus, we will see how we can trust in God's way and in his plan and in his future. And if we've come in struggling today, may we know that we can trust him. And we are amongst friends. We talked about this a couple of weeks ago, didn't we? As we thought about fellowship. We're amongst friends who love us, who can support us as we go through struggles. C.S. Lewis, English author, wrote, God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks to us in our conscience, but shouts to us in our pains. Sufferings is God's megaphone to rouse a deaf world. And just as I say this, I'm reminded, of course, of the passing of Queen Elizabeth in England, and the number of the ways that churches and cathedrals respond, and the many people who go into those places of worship as some sort of response out of their suffering, out of their struggles. In our suffering, in our struggles that we go through at times, we wonder, what is God doing? Where he is? But it's often then that God has our attention. He's saying, I'm here. I am here with you. I'm taking care of you. It's at those times we realize that God is all-powerful. God is compassion. God is love. God does indeed keep his promises despite our suffering. Remember, we thought about John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. God saw us in our struggles and in our suffering, and he reached out to us in Jesus Christ. God sees the mess that sin causes in our lives and in our world. The suffering, the struggles, the pain, the lack of hope and peace. And God says, I've given you a solution. Believe in Jesus and you will know the forgiveness which God gives you. And you have life in all its fullness. And as some of us saw Aaron there, we know that Aaron trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is at peace with him. We won't be promised a life that is pain-free here on earth. But we have the promise and peace of eternal life with the Lord. Because despite the struggles, God is still working out his purpose, freeing his people, leading them, leading us towards the promised land. And so we're going to think about Moses, who was pulled out of the Nile, placed with Pharaoh's daughter. And then in 80 years' time would bring poetic judgment to bear on Pharaoh when his army would be wiped out by the Red Sea. And of course, that is to come. But as we're going through the story of Exodus, I want us also to think this is our story. Like the Israelites, God's going to draw us out of bondage to slavery and to sin because of that salvation won for us in Jesus Christ. Old churches in England, if you look up, often the roof looks like the underside of the ark, and they're often built that way specifically to be a visual picture. The ark, of course, the much bigger version, was what Noah built to spare his family, to spare the animals from God's wrath and judgment. And often, not with ours, but often with fonts, you'll see that they've got eight sides as we remember the eight people who were saved from those drowning waters. And we're going to learn about this baby boy Moses, who was cast into the Nile, not to drown, but he was laid in the same words, a small ark, and then drawn out of the water to lead God's people into freedom. And when we bring a child, a teenager, an adult to baptism, and as we follow the promise of Jesus, we remember the God who saves, the God who loves us. And as we come through the waters, each one of us of baptism, we can look to Jesus and what he has done. Know that God does indeed follow through on all he has promised. God is faithful. God is with us. And God does care. Amen. I invite you to look at the screen or in your bulletins on page 7. Will you stand with me? We're going to recite this creed together that people today are saying across the world about their faith in Jesus. Let's speak these words together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We're going to turn to prayer now. And so I'd invite you to sit or kneel. And Tom's going to bring up the offering for us. We're also in our prayers today going to remember, as it's the anniversary of 9/11, and I hope you're okay with me. I'm also going to bring in a prayer for the royal family from England as well. And today is Grandparents' Day, so we're going to be thanking the Lord for our grandparents. Thanks, Tom. Father God, thank you for all that you bless us with. Thank you for these gifts, Lord God, the gifts that you allow us to give in other ways through our time and our talents as well. Father God, I pray that you may use these to further the work of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, our hope and refuge, in our distress, we come to you. We come remembering those who lost their lives in New York, Washington, D.C., and Pennsylvania. We are mindful of the sacrifice of public servants who demonstrated the greatest love of all by laying down their lives for friends. We commit their souls to your eternal care and celebrate their gifts to a fallen humanity. We come remembering, we come in hope, not in ourselves, but in you. As foundations we once thought secure have been shaken, we're reminded of the illusion of security. In commemorating this tragedy, we give thanks for your presence in our time of need, and we seek to worship you in spirit and in truth, our guide and our guardian. Lord, in your mercy, and God of all consolation, we give you thanks for the life of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth. And we lift before you all the members of the royal family. Be with them, O Lord, as they grieve not only for their queen, but for their beloved mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother. Surround them with your love, remind them of your presence, and encourage them in the sure and certain hope that belongs to all who trust in your Son. Give to His Majesty King Charles enduring wisdom and faith in the service of the people, and of you, his Lord and Master. Grant that his reign may be one of faithful witness and prove to others a source of hope, that they may come to know more fully your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Father God, thank you for grandparents. Thank you, Lord God, for all those
who are grandparents or grandparent figures in our own lives, Lord. And thank you for those children that you've given us to be a witness and example to. Bless our grandparents today, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. As we come to those, lift up to the Lord those people we know of who are sick or struggling at the minute. Let's remember the friends and family of Aaron. Let's also remember Meridal and Patty as their niece Susan passed away also this week. Just invite you in the quietness to lift names up to the Lord. Father God, we do indeed pray and lift up to you Meridal and Paddy and friends and family of Susan, Lord, as they mourn the loss. Comfort them, Father God. Pray especially for Todd and the entire family. And Father God, we indeed also pray and lift up to you friends and family of Aaron. Lord, be with his mother Jan, other members of the family, Elaine, who cared for him so much. Lord, we trust and place these people into your care and your keeping. Father God, we continue to pray for Jean. Lord, we lift up to you Eleanor as she is moving to hospice care. We pray for Dale, her son, Lord, who's also now going to struggle with cancer. We lift up to you Robert and Dolores, Mary, Dorothy. Father God, continue to be with Larry in his treatment. And Bev, Lord God. Lord God, we lift up to you Lil. Pray for Nance, Lord, who's having some family struggles, and continue to pray for your healing hand upon her mother. Lord, continue to be with Rosalind as she recovers from this car accident. Father God, we pray for those struggling with cancer, for Rod and Bruce and Ashley and John. Father God, we lift up to you Kevin. Lord, we lift up to you friends and family of Gwen who've got some struggles. Pray for Roxy and Warren. Pray for Dale. Lord God, we lift up to you friends of Ty, of Wade, and others who you know who they are, Lord. You know their struggles. We pray for Amy. Lord, we thank you for our first responders and healthcare workers, James and others, Lord, who are committed to working for you. Bless and use them, Lord, we pray. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come now to our time of communion. I invite you to take up your pack in your hands. If you didn't get one when you came in, either pop your hand up, and an usher will bring you one, or head to the back, and there are some there. Following the liturgy on the screen, or on page 7 in the bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is our duty and delight at all times and everywhere to give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, for you have enlightened us by the working of the Holy Spirit. Grant that the Spirit who has called and gathered us would guide us in all things, that we be enabled to speak the gospel to others and rejoice in sharing the gift of salvation that is our treasure. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit is one God, through whom with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven we laud and magnify your glorious name. As you take your pack in your hand, on the night when he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." And then after supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you. Amen.
Right, to take your pack in your hand, the side with the wafer on it. Receive the body of Christ, broken for you. And as you turn it over, this is the blood of Christ, shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Will you pray with me? Father God, thank you for feeding us with the body and the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for his sacrifice for each one of us. Lord God, as you've now fed us, you transformed us, send us out to be living sacrifices, to live and to work to your praise and your glory. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we end our service, we're going to sing the song, "How Great Thou Art." Remind us again of all that God has done for each one of us. If you're able to, please stand with me as we sing together.
Consider all the world thy.
Service, we've been thinking about, beginning to think about the life of Moses, and as we travel through the book of Exodus, I hope we see that God is faithful. God is still working out his promises. And if we look at our own life and the situations we might be in, may we also know that God is still faithful despite the situations we might be going through, that we can still look to God and what he has done for each one of us through his son, Jesus Christ. So may you go out this week living out that faithfulness and that trust in your lives to the people that you meet. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine down upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.